Good morning, church family. Welcome. Happy Sabbath. It's beautiful outside. It's a little chilly, but it's warm in here. We have our fellowship, we have our members, and we have Christ with us in here today. So glad each and every one of you can be here. Just an announcement, a reminder about the blue cards. We're going to be picking those up later with your prayer request or your praises. Just please print your requests so we can read them properly, and then they will be picked up later on in the service. I'd like for you to bow your heads and join me in opening prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank Thee so much for this Sabbath day. We thank Thee for the opportunity to be here to praise You and worship You. Now be with us throughout this Sabbath. Help us to receive a blessing from the pastor's sermon and our Sabbath school lesson later on. Thank Thee, O Lord, so much for Your loving care, Your watch, care, and keeping, and watch over our church family members who are not here at this time, but keep them safe wherever they may be. So we invite in Jesus' name. Amen.
Start out with a song. Our first one is called "Oh Lord, How Long?" And the song is basically about trusting in God, because sometimes we can be a little impatient, and you know, wondering if God is going to answer our prayers. And so, if we just be still and wait on Him, He always comes through for us.
Love, Your grace will be our song. You bring new mercies with every rising sun. How long, O Lord, how long, till your glory fills our eyes and our faith is turned to sight, till our thirsty souls are satisfied. How long, O Lord, how long, how long, O Lord, how long?
The Lord is with us always, amen. I thank God every day He loves me. How about you?
As a deer panteth for the water, so my soul longeth after you. Worship you are my strength, my shield. To you alone may my spirit yield. You alone are my heart's desire, and I long to worship you. Silver, only you can satisfy. You alone are the real joy giver and the apple of my eye. You alone are my strength, my shield. To you
to stand and join us for our opening song, He Will Hold Me Fast.
Hold me fast. I could never keep my promises shall last, bought by him at such a cost, he will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. Justice has been satisfied. He will hold me fast. Raised with him to endless life. He will hold me fast. Till our faith is turned to sight. When he comes at last, he will hold me fast.
Generous church family, you have little children. I don't know how many, we're going to count how many times they have to play the song next Sabbath. I mean, praise the Lord. Thank you, church family. He wants to give another, hold on, sweetheart. Get your baby over there. Okay. Good morning and happy Sabbath, boys and girls. Is it a good morning? Okay, is it a happy Sabbath? All right, so let's try it again. Good morning, happy Sabbath, boys and girls. Oh, that's much better. Okay, ignore the voice. I am okay. I won't breathe on you. So I do have a question for you this morning. My question this morning is, what happens when your clothes get too small for you? Okay, what? Wait a minute. We're talking about children, not grown folks that eat too much. We're talking about children that are in the growing process. All right, so what happens? Lord have mercy. What happens when your clothes get too small for you? I'm going to start with Micah.
You need to buy new clothes.
Buy new clothes. All right. All right. What do you do with the old clothes? I'm just saying. What do you do with the old clothes?
Put it in the wash machine.
Yes. Because we should wash it before we do what with them? We should wash the old clothes before we do. Do we keep them in our house forever? No. What do we do with them? We give them away, perhaps to younger church members that are still growing, perhaps to Goodwill, right? But we give them away, and we buy new clothes. Is that the only way to get new clothes? Is there anything else we can do to get new clothes besides buy them from the store? No one? Okay, yeah.
We donate it.
Yes, that's how we get rid of the old ones. We can donate it, or we can give them to other friends or family. Yes, but how else could we get new clothes besides buying them from the store? Listen, we have some help from the, what do we got?
Christmas gift.
Birthday gifts, right? Just because your parents love you. Okay, so wonderful. So our story today is called Room to Grow, and it was written by Maureen Longnecker. Okay, so what happens when your clothes get too small for you? You get bigger clothes, right? Well, animals grow too. But they don't have stores where they buy larger clothes. Instead, some animals do something called molting. Can you say molting? Molting is when animals get rid of their skin, feathers, shell, or wool to grow a new covering. So we're going to start by talking about some goat coats. All righty, mountain goats. They have thick white coats to help them blend in with the snow. Their coats also protect them from cold winters in the mountains of North America. These furry mammals shed their thick coats before the summer heat. Do you wear coats in the summer? No. No, most of us don't wear coats in the summer. So they shed their thick coats before the summer heat. And then the goats grow new thick fur in time for next winter. Did you know that mountain goats' horns don't fall off? Instead, they get bigger every year. All right, our next creature featured has scaly skin. These are called milk snakes. And milk snakes get rid of their old skin all at once. As they grow, new skin forms underneath the old. Soon, the outer skin loosens, and then a milk snake rubs up against the rough surface to slide out of its old skin. The snake's new colors are bright because they are made of new skin. Did you know that the temperature and how much a snake eats affects how often it molts? Our next picture is a flurry of feathers. This bird is called a snow bunting, and like many birds, snow bunting's feathers get worn out and damaged, but these fluffy birds need good feathers so that they can fly and stay warm, but they can't get rid of their feathers all at once, so they molt feathers a few at a time from different parts of their body, and new ones grow where the old ones fall out. Did you know that in the fall, the snow bunting's new feathers are brown and white? But as the feathers wear, the male's feathers turn white and black. And then our final creature featured does a shell swap. When Dungeness crabs start to outgrow their shells, a new shell grows under the old one. To break out of its shell, a crab takes in water to swell like a balloon filling with air. The old shell cracks open and the crab gets away. Then these crafty crustaceans hide in the sand in order to give their new shells time to harden. Did you know that getting rid of their old shells helps Dungeness crabs shed parasites and barnacles that could harm them? So getting rid of the old shell helps them to stay healthy. Well, these animals change what's on the outside. Their changes make them look different, just like when you change your clothes. But the Bible says that God doesn't look at the outside of a person. In 1 Samuel 16, verse 7, it says that God looks at our hearts. So God wants you to have a clean heart, and the only way for your heart to become brand new is to believe in Jesus. When you ask Jesus to save you and to forgive you of your sins, he changes you into a new creation. Your words and your actions and your thoughts all change because your heart is changed by God. Our verse today is 2 Corinthians 5:17. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. The old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. So our creatures featured today, they were animals that all changed what was on the outside. But Jesus can help to make us new on the inside. Raise your hand if you want God to send Jesus into your heart and give you a clean heart, make you new on the inside, and forgive your sins. Amen. Let's put our hands down. Do we have a volunteer for prayer today? Thank you, Micah.
Dear God, thank you for today. Thank you for your Sabbath day of rest. And please change our hearts and ways. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Now, this is the time of our program for our generosity. Generosity supports this church and helps us keep going. And we're very blessed for the generosity of the members. We're in the last 3 months of our fiscal year. Our fiscal year will end at the end of June. So we're looking to try to make our goals for the year for our building mortgage payment and our operating budget. And our operating budget that we're getting money for now becomes our operating budget for next year. So we're not using the operating budget money offerings. Now we're getting that's our money we use starting for 1 July. I would like to ask the congregation to bow with me as we pray over the offering. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for your loving care. We thank you for the generosity and the continued giving of our church family here. We thank you, O Lord, so much for everything. Be with us in this endeavor. Amen. I failed to mention where we give our offering. We have three ways to do it. You can put it in the white box at the end of the pew, end of the sanctuary. You can do it online, or you can mail it to the church, or you can mail it to Nancy directly. Okay. Now we're going to move into the blue cards. If anyone has a blue card, Fred will pick it up. Again, it's nice to see some people that have arrived and come in since we started the program. We're glad to have you here today. Sheanne asked for prayers for her mom and dad. Sonia has a prayer for Sandra, who's going on Monday to VCU for a MRI. Pray that they find out what is going on before she has her surgery. Nancy LaPierre has a special prayer request for Norma. She's in the hospital. Don't know any details about that, so. Okay, she went. Okay, she's been there 3 days from what Vicki is saying, and she went in because she was having a problem breathing. Which one? Okay. Al and Diane have a prayer request for those who have lost loved ones in the bombing in Israel, that we're offering food from the World Kitchen. These are affected by disastrous earthquakes, especially in Taiwan and also in New Jersey and New York last evening. And ask for recovery and healing of Norma, who is now hospitalized. Thank you, Fred. Betty Lou and Mary have a prayer request for Norma. She's in the hospital for the past 3 days with no information at the present time. Thank all of you for remembering Norma. Cindy has a prayer request and a blessing. She wants to thank the Lord for blessing the Easter program, and thank you all so much who made it happen. A blessing to all. And Cindy, your program was wonderful. We thank you for it, for that. Now, where possible, I'd like for the congregation to kneel with me, and we pray over these prayer requests. Dear Heavenly Father, we ask that you hear this prayer. You've heard the requests, the spoken ones, and then there's unspoken ones that you are aware of. We thank thee, O Lord, so much for the ability to be able to speak with you freely and often. We ask that you will bless this congregation and bless those who are not here with us today, but just keeping them safe. We ask again for some way for you, O Lord, to intervene and have some peace in this world. This world is upside down right now in many ways, and we just need to have your intervention, O Lord. We ask that you pray for all the individuals who are trying to help the refugees in Israel, and help that these conflicts in Israel and Ukraine can be brought to an end by negotiated peace settlements, O Lord. We ask again also that you continue to bless this country as we try to move forward. And we ask again, O Lord, for you to watch over our members of the armed forces, wherever they may be. Keep them safe and well, and bring them all back home to their loved ones when their deployments are over. We thank thee, O Lord, so much for your loving care, your watch, care, and keeping. This we have and beg in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good morning, and a happy Sabbath. Joel, that was a beautiful prayer, absolutely beautiful prayer. Pastor Brian's scripture reading this morning is from 1 Thessalonians 5, verses 19 through 22. I think one of the shortest scriptures I've ever read, but one of the most powerful. Do not quench the Spirit. Do not despise prophecies. Test all things. Hold fast what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. We ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen.
Happy Sabbath, Church. It gives me great joy, and it's a blessing to be singing today with Vanessa Wise. Vanessa is an elder at the Calvary Seventh-day Adventist Church in Newport News. She has sung in many states and other countries, but most of all, and Church, I say most of all, she is a faithful servant. And today we want to share our testimony of how wonderful God is through song. In fact, He is more than wonderful. He promised us that He would be a counselor, a mighty God, and the Prince of Peace. He promised us that He would be a Father, and He would love us with a love that would not cease.
Well, I've tried Him, and I found His promises are true. He's everything He said that He would be. Oh, the finest words I know could not begin to tell just how much Jesus really means to me. For He's more wonderful than my mind can conceive. He's more wonderful than my heart can believe. He goes beyond my highest hopes and fondest dreams. He's everything that my soul ever longed for. Everything He's promised, and so much more
than amazing,
more than marvelous, more than miraculous could ever be. He's more than wonderful. That's what Jesus is to me. Well, I stand amazed to think the King of Glory would come to live within the heart of man.
Oh, I marvel just to know He really loves me. When I think of who He is and who I am, for He's more wonderful
than my mind can conceive.
He's more wonderful
than my heart can believe.
He goes beyond my highest hopes and fondest dreams. He's everything
that my soul ever longed for. Everything He promised, and so much more
than amazing,
more than marvelous, more than miraculous could ever be. He's more than wonderful. That's what Jesus is to me. ever longed for, everything he's promised, and so much
more than amazing,
more than amazing,
more than
marvelous,
more than
miraculous could ever be. That's what Jesus is. That's what Jesus is to me. Wonderful to me.
And he's more than wonderful. That's what my Jesus is to me. Happy Sabbath, everyone. Glad to have each and every one of you here today. And if you see me looking a little bit beaten up today, it's because of the children's story. I really wanted to wear a bow tie today, but my shirt got smaller. I will put it that way. Not that I got bigger. Come on, somebody. My shirt got smaller. So when Valerie mentioned that in the children's story today, I felt attacked. I felt personally attacked. So I will be praying for the Spirit to speak to my heart and to calm me throughout. That was a wonderful song, wonderful message and song. And we just want to praise God for the beautiful ministry there. If you don't mind, we'll jump right into the word today. Could you bow your heads with me as we pray? Father God, speak clearly today as we delve into this important topic. And may whatever we do or say find pleasure in you. For we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Today we're speaking on the topic, Don't Quench the Spirit. Don't quench the Spirit. And I am trying to control the slideshow right here. All right, good. So I think I'm here. No. Let me see if that works. Not sure if it's working. All right, so we can go to the next slide. The scripture says, do not quench the Spirit. Thank you, Fred, for reading so beautifully for us. Do not despise prophecies. Test everything. Can you say that with me? Test. How much should we test?
Everything.
Test everything. Hold fast what is good. Abstain from every form of evil. You know, a couple of years ago, I was pastoring in a certain place that shall remain unnamed. And we were having Sabbath school class. One of our members there, new member, we were having a discussion and they were talking about diet. What a wonderful topic to talk about. Talking about diet. Yes, that's what they were. New convert talking about diet. And I think the teacher said something and kept going. And the new convert raised her hand, asked a question, what did you just actually say? And the teacher told her what she said, and then the new convert said, nobody told me that. You guys actually believe that? So she picked up her bag, and she packed her stuff up, and she left. She never came back again. That incident changed the way I do ministry. You're wondering, what did they not tell her about, aren't you? They didn't tell her that as Adventists, we don't eat pork. Now, if you didn't know that, close your ears. Don't let me be the first person to tell you that. All right, but here was somebody baptized into the Seventh-day Adventist Church who did not know that Adventists don't eat pork and only learned about it after they were baptized and came to a Sabbath school class. When she heard it, you hear me closely, right? She packed up her things, turned around, and left. So if I'm a little paranoid today, come on, somebody. If you see me going through all the doctrinal beliefs that we have, it's because I have this fear in my head. You know, I don't want us to be the church that bamboozles people. Can I use that word? You know, sells faith under false pretext. And then you find out, by the way, you know, by the way, by the way, you know. So today we're going to talk about a sticky subject for me. It's a sticky subject for me. It may not be so sticky for you. And I believe more people leave the church, may walk out of the church over prophecy than they do pork. Somebody say amen. Amen. I believe that. But you can't be in the Seventh-day Adventist Church without coming face to face with prophecy. Next slide. Because prophecy is baked into the DNA of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Next slide. The church started with prophecy. If you don't know that, we started with prophecy, the 2300-day prophecy. I may be talking gibberish to some of you right now. Don't worry. We'll explain this in another presentation. But I just want to give an overview today on the proper posture toward prophecy. Amen? So we're doing an overview. If it's the first time you're hearing certain language, don't worry. We will explain it in a next presentation. But I just wanted to give a broad overview so we're all clear on what we believe. The church started with a 2300-day prophecy. Actually started with a dud. Can we be honest? We started with a big mistake. We made a mistake. Come on now. We were wrong. Can we say that? You know, I've been doing a lot of premarital counseling, and one of the hardest things for couples to do sometimes is to what's that word? I don't know what you call it. Apologize, right? Just to say we were. Can you guys practice? We were wrong. Say, let me hear you say it. Because, no, some of y'all didn't say nothing. That was your opportunity right there, and you missed it. Started with prophecy, they were wrong. 457 AD to 1844, they did the whole 2300-day prophecy, and the great disappointment. It's all there. You can check the history books. We started with a mistake. And after that, we said, all right, no more date setting for some of us. Others of us kept making the same mistake. And you will even hear current people doing the same thing, trying to predict the date and the time when Jesus would return. So our church started with prophecy. Secondly, our church studies prophecy. This is one of the few churches that will give you a steady diet of Daniel and Revelation seminars. Come on, somebody. Amen. You know, all of them beasts, the lion and the leopard and the bear and the nondescript beast and the little horn and all those things and the sanctuary. I mean, give you nightmares for weeks. Give you the hibby-jibbies, whatever. Some of us have learned not to read Revelation at night, then we can't sleep, all right? But this is a church that studies prophecy. We believe in prophecy. And in fact, prophecy is central to our church. You know, our church is steered by prophecy. And now here comes the controversial part. All of this is controversial, really, for some people. The ministry of Ellen White has been a blessing in establishing various lines of ministry that have come to define Adventist impact across the globe. You can't think of one thing that Adventists do today that Ellen White didn't have some influence in the way we do it, whether it's our medical ministry, our educational ministry, the way we move pastors around. Thank you, Ellen White. Come on, somebody. No, nobody? Go say, all right, thank you, Ellen White, for teaching the church that you need to move your pastors every few years. We are so glad. We are so happy. You can see that I'm thrilled, right? Yeah, everything. And it's kind of funny that in a church that's so heavily influenced by a woman, we still have issues with women in leadership. That's strange to me. That just throws a curve. That was an extra thing right there, you know, but I just kind of had to say it, kind of get it off my chest while I'm here. Yeah, but there it is. And I think part of the problem that we struggle with as it relates to Ellen White and prophecy in our church, we really have to be clear. Are we a prophetic movement? Are we primarily a prophetic movement? Or are we just a movement with a prophet? See, there's a difference. There's a difference. And I believe that people are asking questions. Most Seventh-day Adventists will tell you, that's so small, I can't even read that. But it's from, you see, every time I come to church and I look at the screen, I realize I need glasses. Anybody? Yep, I do need glasses. But this is from a survey that was done, Beyond Beliefs. Are you hearing? Beyond Beliefs, what millennial young adults really think of the 28 beliefs of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. This was a study done in 2014. And one of the major issues that they have, I have access to the study, is they were concerned that when the church talks about we have the spirit of prophecy, we normally identify it so closely with Ellen White that the focus becomes on one person rather than the church being a prophetic movement. Are you still with me? In other words, we need to be careful when we talk about the church being a prophetic movement, that's really what we mean and not just a movement with a prophet. We are a prophetic movement, not simply a movement with a prophet. And here's what I mean. G.I. Butler, a former president for the church. Ryan, next slide for me. Oh, there it is. See? He did change it to the next slide. All right. Butler talks about it this way. He says, the ministry of Ellen White has been very important to our church. There isn't any area that she hasn't blessed the ministry of our church. But when we look at what Ellen White herself says, next slide, we can keep going. And yep, there it is. She wrote a book entitled The Spirit of Prophecy. And do you know what she talks about in that book entitled The Spirit of Prophecy? Take a wild guess. Mark said it. You are such a brilliant student. She talks about prophecy. And specifically, she literally goes through the history of God using prophets from the beginning of time all the way through. Now, raise your hand if you think you need a prophet. Let me see. Those who think they need a prophet. All right, put your hand down, Mark. You're a good student. Raise your hand if you think you don't need a prophet. Come on. Anybody brave enough to think they don't need a prophet? All right, let me ask it another way. Let me see those who love to follow, love people giving you advice that you didn't ask for. Just raise your hand. You absolutely love getting advice that you didn't ask for. Raise your hand if you absolutely hate it when people stick their nose in your business. You can raise your hand. Amen. See, that would mean you would struggle with a prophet. Amen. That was a test right there. Because really, the truth of the matter is that the Bible tells us in Joel chapter 2, verse 28 and 29. Next slide. Let me make sure. Keep going. Yep. Says, and it shall come to pass afterward that I will pour out my spirit on how many people? And here it is, your sons and your daughters. Notice that's plural. Your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. And also on my maidservants and to my, no, men servants, and on my maidservants, I will pour out my spirit in those days. So the prophecy really tells us that regardless of your age, come on somebody, regardless of your gender, whether you're male or female, and it's not going to be on one person alone. In fact, there used to be a fable among Adventists. Can I talk about Adventist fables? That God called two other people to the prophetic ministry before her, and they both rejected it, and then she accepted it. That's what you heard, right? Well, one of the former presidents for the Oakwood University wrote a book entitled The Forgotten, The Unknown Prophet, where he talks about Hazel Ross, which was the African-American gentleman that first received the visions that Ellen White received. And he talks about it, the fact that he never turned his back on what God called him to do. He was faithful in what God called him to do. But Adventists have a way of wanting to be unique. Come on, Adventists. So Ellen White was not the only prophet that we know of in even our own movement that was used by God. And that's backed up by Scripture. Joel chapter 2, 28 and 29. All flesh. So let me just give you a free advertisement right here. I was telling Sister Diane, Elder Al, at our Wednesday meeting, I gave them the story of Elisha with a H, right? Stop me if you've ever heard this story before. That when Elisha died and was buried, they were burying some guy, and the raiders came and they decided, hey, we're getting out of here. So they just threw the guy in Elisha's tomb, and the guy was resurrected. A few people heard it. It's a weird story. It messes with our beliefs on the state of the dead. It does, because it's telling you that Elisha had power even when he was dead. His bones had power. And now this will get me fired somewhere, so let me go ahead and say it. There's a problem in your church if the most powerful person in your church is a dead person. Can I say it one more time? If the only person who can do anything miraculous in your church is somebody who's been dead and their bones, you know, decayed, you can picture it? We know they were powerful when they were alive, but now that they're dead, there's no successor. So every time you want something miraculous to happen, you got to go back, go visit the dead person. I know, I'm not going to work. Can't say it. I was about to say where I can't work, but it's fine. They know I won't be working there. Amen. So, all right. So in other words, prophecy is something that God uses as a blessing to our church. 1 Thessalonians wasn't written to us, but the principles there are good for us. But nowadays, prophecy has fallen on hard times, and the attitudes toward the prophetic have increasingly gotten negative. Next slide. But prophecy is a gift of the Spirit used to give the contemporary church present direction. Y'all need a prophet because we need to know which way to go. And the Bible does tell us, surely the Lord does nothing unless he reveals it to his servants, plural, the prophets. All right, so here is it. There's another book entitled Living 28. fresh perspectives on practicing faith. And I can't read that either. It says, prophecy is a gift of God's mercy, pointing to a father who does not leave his children walking in the dark. He gives us the amount of light we need according to the path we are on. He sends warnings, an opportunity to move from our own doom, as he did when he saved Nineveh, as he did with Israel. Prophets are spokespersons of God to shepherd his people at times when they are in danger of getting lost. And then he quotes Deuteronomy 18, verse 15. The Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among you, from your brethren. You must listen to him. So, when used properly, next slide, the prophetic ministry isn't primarily about establishing new doctrines, but rather about setting direction for the church. I want you to underline that. Prophets don't teach new doctrine. They give direction. Amen? They give direction. And that's one of the reasons why, I'm going to tell you the truth, I don't like people giving me directions. Come on now, if you're a man in here, just own it up. Don't look at your wife. Wives, don't look at your husbands. You know, we don't like taking directions. I told you not to look at your specific other, right? Boy, oh boy, people don't like taking directions at all. You know, I mean, if you really read Ellen White, a lot of times she can come off as a nagging old lady. Can I say that? I know I'm not going to get hired certain places. And people use her that way. What you doing? Oh, you can't do that. Ellen White says, right here, Testimonies to the Church, Volume 6, page 193. Behold, thou shalt not have fun on the Sabbath. Amen. You see what I'm saying? That's what we use it to do. But that's not the point of prophecy. It's not to create new doctrine, but it's to give direction. What should we do? Prophecy answers the question, what should we do? Not what should I believe, but what should I do? And so today, the text warns us here in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 19 through 22, about some attitudes toward receiving direction. Because not only are we praying to God, but God is speaking to us in return. Are you still with me? But if we aren't listening, then we will have certain attitudes towards the prophetic word. And in these attitudes, we run the risk of silencing the Spirit and suffocating the Spirit's influence in the church. And oh, how much we need the Spirit in these days. So, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, 19 through 22, addresses three attitudes. The first attitude, that's the dismissive attitude. Come on now. You know the dismissive attitude, right? Huh? What'd you say? Right, that's the ones that don't want to hear nothing. Don't mention it. We reject anything of a prophetic nature. We have a low trust attitude toward the supernatural. We view anything of a prophetic nature as being conniving and manipulative. We can point out all the con artists, right? All the snake oilsmen. Who have brought ill repute to the faith, and their fake and false alarms. So don't talk to me about the earthquake in New Jersey and how that points to whatever God is doing. Come on, I'm tired of y'all. Yeah, amen. Don't tell me that the solar eclipse on Monday. You know, folks who are always peddling conspiracies. It kind of leads us to the place where we just don't want to hear nothing of that nature, all right? Kind of laugh at the naivety of those who have any faith whatsoever. And people with a dismissive attitude towards prophecy consider themselves so sophisticated and look at following prophecy as a dangerous precedent. We remember Jim Jones. Come on, folks. We remember Waco. We have reason to be skeptical. But that's one attitude. What's the next attitude? The next attitude is the domineering attitude. Oh, yes. This is probably... I can't say that. If I say that, might as well say it. This is probably the dominant attitude in our church towards prophecy. Can I? We see everything as, you know, being prophecy. It's like, and we're going to tell you about it. We accept everything Ellen White writes, and we practice all of it. Every time. Even the things that give you two different answers, we practice it as well. We always chasing after the next newest predictions. We watch with anxiety every single occurrence and wonder why the pastor, come on now, you know we talk about it. Pastor, we haven't heard you preach about the earthquake in New Jersey yet. Diverse place, yeah. We haven't heard you talk about the meaning of COVID and the vaccine. Come on, somebody. No matter the failure of the prophecy or the prophet, there's always another reason why we still believe. We're passionate about sharing with others. Even when it's clear, folks have stopped listening to you a long, long time ago. And people with this attitude wear rejection as a badge of honor rather than a sign that maybe they need to change their approach. Paul talks about the attitudes, dismissive, domineering. But what Paul recommends is the third attitude, and that's the discerning attitude. Are you still with me? Paul says, no prophecy or prophet should be unceremoniously dismissed or uncritically accepted. Don't just dismiss it, but don't just swallow everything that you hear. My dream is that we would have a more discerning spirit and that we know that Scripture commands us. Notice, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, these five short statements are all imperatives. They are not suggestions. They are commands. You got to test every spirit. And if that feels uncomfortable to you, just know that Paul even encouraged reception and research when it comes to listening to the word of God being preached. Paul talked about the Bereans. Mark mentioned it. That they received what Paul was saying. They listened. Come on, somebody. They listened, but then they went and they checked. So let me give you a little free advertisement. I wouldn't trust anybody who tells me, oh, just believe me. You can't get me to trust you if I can't verify it. I had a friend who wanted to sell me some products. Good friend of mine. And I asked him, where can I read about what these things actually does? He said, well, that's proprietary information, right? Because they can't just show you the secret to how they do the stuff. Because then everybody would do it. I said, well, that's a problem then. Then he's like, so I'm like, so how am I going to know if this thing works? He said, well, you know me, right? You can trust me. I said, absolutely not. Are you hearing me? I'm not trusting you just because you and I are friends. Are you still with me? We don't do that here. If Paul can be questioned. An apostle of God saw a vision from Jesus, then every single prophet, pastor, spokesperson, healer, whatever, needs to stand the scrutiny of the Word of God, because the Word of God says we have a responsibility to test every spirit. You test everything. So the faith that honors God is a faith that tests any message claiming to be from God to ensure it's authentic before you accept it. Sometimes if we go to the store, sometimes, you know, I feel so bad today. My son walked by me in the children's offering and waved me off as if I couldn't or wouldn't give any money to the children. You know, just waved me off. He's like, oh, we don't have to collect from you, right? So I'm about to talk about money. You know, on the off chance when you have a $100 bill and you go to the store and you're going to use that to buy something, they don't just look at you and say, oh, you're in a nice suit. We trust you. Oh, we love you so much. The customer is always right. They will check that bad boy right in front of your face. So, man, what do you think I'm doing? Counterfeit? They're like, no, we just have a policy. We trust, but we verify. We listen, but we check it. We got to check it out ourselves. So here are four main ways to test the prophetic spirit. And I gave two books there that I can't even read. Next slide. I'll tell you what they are. Roald Dittering writes about the Handbook of SDA Theology, and Richard Rice wrote Reign of God. I know if you did any type of religion at an Adventist college, you may have read the book Reign of God before, but it's a really good textbook. I got four tests that they talk about that you need to do with any prophetic words. And I'll just go through the four of them real quick. We ran out of time, so I won't be able to read the scriptures, but the scriptures are there, so you can check for yourself afterwards. The prophetic affirms the teaching of Scripture. First thing, Isaiah chapter 8, verse 20 tells us, to the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them. Remember I told you, prophecy is not about teaching new doctrine. It's about giving direction. So number one, the thing has to line up with what the Bible already says. If it doesn't, you don't even have to worry about it. Number two, test the prophets. The prophetic builds up the body of Christ. So it's supposed to be a benefit. Let me help you out a little bit. There is no spiritual gift called, I'm going to give them a piece of my mind. Amen? Right? There's no spiritual gift to curse people. Amen? That's not a spiritual gift. It's not a spiritual gift to break things down. That's not, no. The Bible talks about edification. And Matthew chapter 7, verse 15 through 20, we can skip through that. What the Bible is really saying is, by your fruits you shall know them. You know, if your prophetic ministry, if you're preaching, if your teaching is divisive, it just brings division. You know, something is wrong there. Something is wrong. So you got to check what effect is your ministry having. Not everybody's going to love you. Not everybody's going to like you. But there has to be some positive impact for the word that God has given you to share with others, if you feel you have a prophetic word. Number three, the prophetic gives reliable guidance for the future. So many of our parents were very prophetic, said if you don't study, you're going to work at McDonald's. That's very prophetic. Man, it's a reliable guide. Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 21 and verse 22, it warns you, if a prophet says stuff, and nothing happens, you don't have to be afraid of them. I remember a guy, I was in Salt Lake City, he told me he was leaving, and said he wanted to say goodbye to the church, got up and mentioned, if we don't keep feast days, the Lord is going to destroy the city in 1 year. All the kids were in church. They started trembling. I said, well, number one, I don't think that lines up with scripture, so I'm not worried about it, right? And Salt Lake City is still there. This is like 7-8 years afterwards. False prophet. Amen. So I'm not worried about stuff when you talk stuff and nothing happens. It doesn't give me confidence that the Lord has said anything to you. Can I say that out loud? Amen. So you don't have to worry when people say stuff and nothing happens. All right, and then the third one, final one, which is the most important one. The prophetic lifts up Jesus. It's not about the prophet. It must lift up Jesus, exalt Jesus. So can I help us as Adventists? We can go to the scripture, but I'll just rant a little bit as I close and run to my next spot. You know, when you preach something like this, you gotta run quickly so nobody stones you afterwards. It's a plan, you know what I'm saying? Smart, it's very smart. What we love to do, give people stuff that scares them. And I know our church now is studying the great controversy for Sabbath school. Like, wonderful. I mean, that works so well when you just had an earthquake and you're going to have a solar eclipse and people already in this frenzy, you know, and all of that. Good stuff. And we have this idea, we really should give the great controversy to everybody who has never heard about our church before and has no clue what we believe in. That's a great introduction. Show them all the scary stuff we believe, that we think, you know, people are just going to start killing people. And Charlie's raising his hand. He's like, yeah, I love that scary stuff. I don't like to sleep at night. You know, but really, why we don't start with steps to Christ? Why we don't start with, this is what we believe about Jesus. Lift up Jesus first. And what the Bible says, if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. A lot of us think that's not enough. If your prophecy isn't talking about the scary stuff, well, Pastor, you ain't preaching it right. People need to be shaken in their boots. You need to scare them into salvation. And I think that is the wrong approach. The Bible tells us in 1 John 4:1-3, how you test the word of a prophet is, how do they talk about Jesus? It must be Jesus came in the flesh. And it's not simply by parroting the words, Jesus came in the flesh. But your prophecy must have some practical benefit for people where they are right now, right here, right now. It must be incarnational, meaning it shouldn't be so otherworldly that it has no practical benefit to what they're going through right now. And I'm not saying predictive prophecy doesn't do that, but prophecy is not simply about prediction. It is about lifting up Jesus. I think I went way over time, but I needed to say this because I don't want to baptize anybody. And you hear me telling you, we plan on baptizing a lot of people. Amen. Amen. I believe it. I'm just going to say it, and then the Lord will let it happen. But when it happens, we're not going to be talking about stuff that we believe, and somebody say, well, what did you? What? You guys didn't tell me this. You know, you tricked me. You hid it from me. You just kind of kept it hidden. And then you got me. And now that you got me, you're telling me, oh, by the way, We believe in all of these other things. I think we need to be ethical and share with people the faith that we have. And there are some things we have to wrestle with because there are some forces in our church that are not very balanced. Can I say that? I would want to pull us in a certain direction. But as long as we keep focusing on Jesus, I believe God is going to bless us. Let's pray. I won't be able to pray at the end. I have to run to the Newport News Church. But if you need to talk further about this, my email and phone number are on the bulletin. If you're online watching this, my phone number is on our website, williamsburgsda.org, I think our .com. And just write me, text me, call me, email me. And we can talk, we can reason together. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for the opportunity to share this word today. And Lord, we want to be honest and open as we wrestle with the deep truths of Scripture. And as we seek to lift up Jesus, even in the prophetic. Lord, we pray that you will bless us as we learn the discipline and the humility of following prophetic advice when it applies to us. Lord, we know you don't want us to have a dismissive spirit. You don't want us to have a domineering spirit, but you want us to have a discerning spirit that knows the difference between your voice and men's ideas. So lead us and guide us, Lord, for we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.
Please stand with us as we sing our closing song, Made Me Glad. When you think about God, do you get happy? Does he make you glad? Everything that he's done for us, this song is going to mention several things that he is for us, and I'm so thankful for it.
Shelter, strong tower.